Okay, very good. So let's. Okay. Okay, so welcome back to the condo model, which I started last lecture, and just to remind you what we were doing. So you're looking at the Hamiltonian. So first I was looking at the simple case of just having an SU2 spin, and also the electrons in SU2 spin representations. And so we had this Hamiltonian where Vf is the Fermi velocity, but we will set that to one momentarily. And then actually, really, these fermions now are really going to be just left-handed ones, because I do this analytic continuation to negative values of the radial coordinate. So then we have this Kondo coupling, which is called lambda k, so not to be confused with the Tuft coupling. And I will want to very soon consider now a large n limit, where essentially lambda k times n will be kept fixed and n goes to infinity, where n will then be the spin group. And then we have this interaction between a localized spin operator, which is only, okay, so the most important point in this interaction term is, of course, this delta function. So the spin operator just sits at the origin and doesn't move, but of course it can move in time. And that was this is for the free electrons for those. So for this you can build a current, and that will interact in this way. Okay, and so then lots of people asked me, so I drew this picture where you actually could see the logarithmic rise of the resistivity with temperature at very low energies. And so for this case of iron with magnetic impurities in this very old measurements from the 60s, which Kondo was considering, this starts at about 4 Kelvin, so to just give you an order of magnitude. So many people asked about this yesterday. Okay, so and now because I gave lots of reasons why it would be interesting to look at this in ADS-CFT yesterday, and so, but of course, as always, we need to take a large n limit to do this in a simple way. And so now let's look at the large N Kondo model. So where we have an SUN spin symmetry, and this operator S will be in some suitable representation of the symmetry, as I'm going to explain right now. And so what I will explain to you is that in that case, so here this, you can view this as an ultraviolet fixed point where a renormalization group flow is triggered by this operator just at the boundary, so at this position. And so actually this operator turns out to be marginally relevant. So it's a marginal operator, but when you switch on the quantum corrections, it becomes relevant. And then it drives the system out of this UV fixed point where everything is just free. And so we will get this renormalization group flow. But then, as I will also argue to you right now, and also has already been studied within field theory, actually there will be a condensation taking place near the IR fixed point. And then in some sense, your large N Kondo model, which will look like a superconductor in 0 + 1 dimensions. Now you should immediately say, this can't be, you can't have a phase transition in 0 + 1 dimensions. And then the answer to this is, well, if n is really truly infinite, then you can. Okay. So what will happen, and so this has already been considered in the field theory without any gauge gravity duality. So it turns out that for n going to infinity, the Kondo model will be described by a superconducting model in 0 plus 1 dimensions. And so there's a condensate forming and okay, so for finite n the phase transition turns into a crossover. Because you can't have a phase transition in such low dimensions unless you're in the notch in the mid. Okay, so, and as I already mentioned yesterday, to actually do this, and okay, so I should mention that there were some authors already in the 80s looking at this in the field theory side, in particular P.S. Kuhlmann and also Nathan Andree. So he is the one actually who used the beta ansatz to solve the condo model in the large n limit. Then you actually use this trick of writing, so this A is now an index relating to a representation of SUN. And so you just replace this by a bilinear in fermions in such a way. So by which you introduce these extra fermions. And so you take A goes from 1 to n squared minus 1. So essentially you're looking, if you want, at the fundamental representation of these matrices. And this also means that these fields transform in the fundamental representation of Lagrange group. Okay, so I should mention right away a difference between what happens in condensed matter physics and what will happen in the gauge gravity duality model, because here in the condensed matter case, the symmetry is just a global spin symmetry. But since we take the ordinary SUN of ADS CFT later on to model this, in our case, the symmetry will actually be gauged. Okay, so our model will have slight difference from this original model. And okay, so now if you write this in terms of these bilinears, so of course these fermions also live only in 0 plus 1 dimensions, okay? Then somehow you increase the number of degrees of freedom, okay? And this can't be. So if we had a certain number of degrees of freedom before, now we should have the same amount of degrees of freedom. And this means if you now study an equation of motion for these chi's, you will have to impose a constraint on them. So there will have to be a constraint which fixes the symmetry, so which fixes these to be non-dynamical again. Okay, and so okay, I should say, so these TA are generators of SUN. Now, to impose a constraint on the chi, you look at followers. The following, you look at the states in in the impurity Hilbert space, and so you discover that the states in the impurity Hilbert space are obtained by acting on the vacuum with Q, with a number Q of these chi's. And because these are fermions, then this means you get a totally anti-symmetric representation. Of SUN. And so to be slightly more precise, this will be a totally anti-symmetric tensor product of the fundamental representation, because the chi's are in the fundamental, and with this will be of rank Q. So if you like Young tableaus, then you will just have a column of Q boxes. Okay, so there will be Q boxes in this representation. Okay, and now if you choose a particular state in this Hilbert space, this then tells us the constraint we have to take, and we impose that the charge density which you make out of these chi's should be equal to Q. Okay, so this will be your constraint. And Q is the rank of this representation. Okay, so, I'm creating states, and I choose one of them, and that's labeled by a rank, so this corresponds to a rank Q representation of SUN, and then I take this to fix the charge density of these guys. Okay. Good. Okay. And actually, now it's actually very nice is that this interaction looks a little complicated because you have this product in the space of representations of SUN, but you can trade in the large N limit, you can trade this interaction S times J for a product of two scalar operators. And that's what I'm going to show to you now. So the Condon interactions simplifies considerably in the large N limit. And let me show you how. Because, so you can introduce an operator. So we introduce an SUN singlet operator called curly O, and this will be defined by just the product of one of these left-handed electron operators times one of these fermions, these defect fermions. And that's gauge invariant, because this will be in the antifundamental and the fundamental of the gauge group. So this is gauge invariant. So now, so I also, if you count the engineering dimensions of these fields, you find that the dimension of this operator is actually a half. And then we can now use the completeness relation for these TA matrices. So using TA alpha beta TA gamma delta. So I replace these IJs by alphas and betas for no reason. Then this will be a half delta alpha delta beta gamma minus 1 over n delta alpha beta delta gamma delta. And then this term you can actually neglect in the large n limit. So these indices go from 1 to n. And then you can see that your interaction, which looks like this, this you can now write. Okay, so here this J was actually psi. So I'm dropping these L's now. Okay, so all the electrons will now be chiral. So and so I drop this L for convenience. And so there's another psi here. And then we multiply this with the spin operator, which is psi dagger T A psi. And so now in the large n limit, the nice thing is by using this relation and dropping this term, we then just get so 1/2 lambda delta, and then so this is now your operator, which looks like a double trace operator. And let me just write the subleading term for completeness, but you can drop this. So we neglect this for n going to infinity. And so, okay, so this is our operator now. And so it looks a little bit like a double trace operator, although you don't see any trace anywhere on my blackboard. But it's just a product of two gauge invariant operators. Okay, so then for that reason, you can call it double trace. Okay. And now, so you see that your model is simplified considerably, because instead of just looking at this complicated interaction, now what you do, you keep this kinetic term, and here you just write O dagger, okay, which you can only do in the large n limit. And so people studied this 30 years ago in condensed matter physics, and now comes the punchline. So I was talking about these superconductors. Actually, when you now study this algebraic flow and go to DIR, this operator is actually going to condense. And so you have a new ground state, and there's a phase transition temperature. Okay, so yesterday I already showed you that the beta function is negative for this operator. And so this means there was a scale at which the coupling diverges. And so this will still be the case. So this Kondo coupling diverges at a Sturm coupling scale which is called the Kondo temperature. And then, as people discovered in field theory, so in addition, there is a temperature Tc, which is roughly of the same order but a little smaller than Tk, where the operator O condenses. And you can actually calculate this analytically. So Tc is given analytically, but it's a slightly involved computation. And what you find is that so the relation, so essentially Tc will be some harmonic number times Tk. And so a harmonic number means it's some series which you have to calculate, something like sum is k is equal to 1 to n over 1 over k. Okay, so you see it's a slightly involved calculation which you can do in field theory, but then you get these two scales. So one is the one which are of course related to each other. So one is where the coupling diverges, the coupling of this double trace operator, and then there's this other temperature. So below we have a condensate. So this operator has an expectation value. And of course, yeah. Yeah, okay, so, yeah, okay, I should, it's not quite correct what I wrote. I should just write some function of this HK. Yeah, sorry. But I can't remember, so I should have written this down, but I didn't. So there's some function of this harmonic number which gives this, but Tc is definitely smaller than Tk, yeah. Good point. I think you probably it goes to infinity. If well, does it converge?
It blows in a
Yeah. Okay. Don't nail me down on this now. I just want to say it's an analytic calculation is a bit complicated and it involves some harmonic numbers and okay. I don't remember now exactly what this is related to in this calculation, but okay. Just remember you can do this analytically. I'm sorry for not being aware of the details. Let me say some important things. One of which is there's a, of course, if we have a condensate, then there's a spontaneous symmetry breaking. And actually, what happens is that the U1, so the spurious U1s, so when you write your S with this chi dagger chi, then you introduce a spurious U1 symmetry which wasn't there before. And then, of course, there's this U1 of the electrons, and that gets broken to the diagonal subgroup. Okay, so essentially you just introduce an artificial symmetry, but then this is just spontaneously broken. Okay, so, when you introduce 1 over n corrections, then this transition becomes a crossover. Okay, so the key point is at large n and low t, the Kondo effect is a 0 plus 1 dimensional superconductor, and the important point is it's triggered by this double trace deformation. Obviously, it becomes important, but I think it okay. I still okay. In the remainder of this lecture, I will just talk about a limit where n is strictly infinite. Okay, since people have studied this in condensed matter physics and have calculated 1 over n corrections, I still believe it's dominant. Let's keep n strictly infinite for everything in this talk. So my double trace deformation. Okay, so that's a result from quantum field theory. But now we can all these beautiful te put all these beautiful techniques to work, which we learned in this course of lectures, because this will be our guide for constructing a holographic model. Okay, and so that's what we want to do now. Okay, maybe very quickly, because I think this will become relevant later on. I mentioned yesterday that this model has some relation to the so-called Tsarchev-Yee model, and I maybe just very quickly tell you about this relation. Okay, and so this is a model which was written down in 1993. And so what they did is to start from the Ising model. And so it's with a large number of sites, and I don't think it's specified in how many dimensions. Probably 2 is the easiest. And then you have this. Okay, and now you can do the same large n limit by replacing these s's. So again, the spin component by this chi dagger alpha t a alpha beta chi beta, just as I did for this Kondo model. And then, of course, if you take this and insert this into here, then you can use the same completeness relation, and then you get something which involves four fermions. And then there's an essential step, which I'm not going to discuss in detail because it's a bit of a sidetrack from what we want to do. Then there's this averaging over disorder, which takes you to a single site model in zero plus one dimension. Okay, so so let me just write this in words. So the idea is now to reduce to a single site model by averaging over disorder. Okay, I'm not going to explain how this is done. And then obviously there's also the large N limit. And then what you get is a Hamiltonian, which looks like this, 1 over 2n to the 3/2 sum over alpha, beta, gamma, delta. And you know this goes to capital N, and then now you get these couplings written. Instead of ij, they have now four indices, which are alpha, beta, and gamma, and delta. And then you get this term, which is actually precisely this Sachdev-Yee model. And then they have another term, which we can now also explain, because this, they have a chemical potential, which is like a Lagrange multiplier, to impose this constraint, which I was talking about. So so the charge density, so this term you can view as imposing this constraint on these Abrikosov pseudofermions. Okay, so so here, of course, these are complex fermions, and so especially they are vial fermions, and then in the Sachdev-Yee-Kitaev model, these are replaced by Majorana fermions. Nevertheless, there's some relation between the model we are going to consider and this Sachdev-Yee model. The only difference is that we have these electrons, which are in 1 plus 1 dimensions and which couple to our model and which will allow for this condensate. But nevertheless, also in our case, most of the physics happens at this single site in 0 plus 1 dimensions. Okay. Good. So now, let me give you a recipe of how to construct the gravity dual. And so I thought, to make good use of my last 45 minutes, let me first give you a summary of how this is done and why it's important. And then I'll start doing it and we just see how far I get. I think this is better than starting with the details right now and then not telling you the punchline at the end. So let me tell you the punchline first and then the details. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I should. I mean, there's this average over this order which is involved, but which I don't want to discuss here because in our model it doesn't play any role. It's not there. Okay. But this is, yes, you are right. Good. Yes. To the real quantum model. Well, okay, to some extent, this is just what I want to tell you. I'm going to tell you how to construct a gravity dual, and then I tell you the results which you get. I mean, okay, for instance, there are some properties of the two-point function. You can calculate two-point functions for this model, and they have some particular features which are slightly different from the standard quantum model because you write them in terms of this O. This operator O clearly you don't have if you are just an SU2 quantum model. But this is a good point. So the question is, are the universal features in this large N which are different from the SU2? And I think, I hope within the next 10 minutes I will answer this question. Okay, so let me give you a summary of the strategy in the results. So how to construct this and what are the results which you get. Okay, so first of all, we actually can use the brains to, because, okay, we know what we want. So in ADS-CFT, you can only essentially look at gauge invariant operators. But so we certainly want this operator somehow to appear in our model. And we want this operator to appear in our model. And then we want the condensate to appear in our model. Okay, so this already gives some indications what we want to have. And then, of course, we want an electron current. And so what we do is we use so-called brain probes. So essentially D7 and D5 brains. So what is a brain probe? Well, essentially, we start again with the D3 brains, which we had before. And then we will take n, and n goes to infinity. But now, because we want fields in the fundamental representation, we will put some very small number, like 1 of these, into the background of the D3 brains. And then in this limit where the number of D3 brains goes to infinity, we assume that we can ignore the back reaction. Certainly for the D7s, okay, there's some issues about this, but let me not worry about this too much now, because anyway, we will take this as a motivation to establish the dual geometry and the field operator map. So you should say, take this as a nice example and to see how useful actually these brain constructions are when you want to devise a dual model. And it just tells you, I mean, there's many possibilities of finding interesting gravity duals for interesting theories, and this is just one particular nice example. Okay, so that's what we're going to do. And so this will allow us to establish precisely the correct quantum numbers for fields on the supergravity theory, which are dual to those operators which we need. On the other hand, we will discover that the model we get in this way is super complicated and we cannot solve it. I will show you why. Okay, but then since we are physicists and we want to say something about the quantum model, we just invent a simpler model which has the essential features. Okay. Good. So because this essentially this happens because a potential appears in this model which we don't know, which I think can possibly be calculated, but is rather complicated. And okay, let me come to this in a second. So now the next step is to consider a simpler so-called bottom-up model. Again, this is something which is pretty standard to do in ADS-CFT. So, of course, this original model which we're going to write here will be in 9 plus 1 dimensions, but obviously since our model is in 0 plus 1, or I should say it's in 1 plus 1 dimension with a 0 plus 1 dimensional defect, so there we want really a 2 plus 1 dimensional gravity dual with a 1 plus 1 dimensional defect. So if we have 10 dimensions, there are way too many, and maybe we just don't need to consider all these extra dimensions. So essentially, we just take those dimensions which are directly obvious how they appear there. I make this more precise. So this is generally what is referred to as a bottom-up model. So what you gain is that it becomes a lot simpler. The price you pay is that you know what your field operator map is. You know that you are in a strongly coupled field theory, but you can't really write a microscopic Lagrangian anymore for the interactions between the elementary fields in this theory. And that's true for all bottom-up models. I mean, you know the symmetries of your dual field theory, but you don't know the microscopic Lagrangian. Okay, nevertheless, you will see that we can do pretty useful things with this. And the simpler gravity dual model, so for the gravity dual, which is inspired by the brain construction. Okay, I will show this to you in a sec. And essentially, this will have an ADS3 black brain geometry. Okay, so this is actually what will be dual to our electrons, and then we need a defect with an ADS2 defect, so where those fields dual to these 0 plus 1 dimensional operators live. Okay, so we have this 1 plus 1 dimensional free electron field theory, which couples to the 0 plus 1 dimensional defect degrees of freedom, and so we add a radial direction to both of them, which gives us ADS3 with an ADS2 defect. Okay, so now let's establish the field operator map. Okay, maybe I shouldn't rub off the blackboard, because here we want this operator and we want this operator. Let me continue over there, and then we can keep these for a second. Or did I write the board here? Maybe I can. Okay, so I can continue here. Good. Okay, so first of all, we have an electron current. So that was this J. And so essentially, you can write this as psi bar gamma mu TA psi. Okay. And as I will show to you using this brain construction, we can identify this, the dual field. So the dual field has to be some gauge field. And actually, for this gauge field, we will take a Chern-Simons gauge field. Okay, and the next really important operator will be a charge density, which will be this chi bar chi, which we know essentially the boundary will correspond to this these degrees of freedom. And so this means we will need a gauge field in the dual theory, and that will be a component of a gauge field which I call little a mu in the ADS2 space. And so then we can look at the near boundary behavior of this field by solving its equation of notion, which I'm going to write in a minute. And so here we will discover that this will go like capital Q over Z, so where Z is this coordinate which I introduced beforehand, plus a chemical potential where this Q is essentially this little Q which we had over there divided by N. Okay. So this is a gauge invariant operator, which obviously plays an important role, and it also counts the degrees of freedom at this defect, and so we need that. And finally, so what's very important is we need this operator O, and so O is a complex scalar, so this means we need a gravity dual, which is a complex scalar. Scalar in ADS2. Okay. No, of course not. Okay, I will come to this point. So all of these fields will be in the back. This will be in an ADS3. Okay, so you can write an Einstein-Hilbert action in ADS3, but this is non-dynamical. But nevertheless, in this background, you will get equations of motion for these fields. I will write those for you in a sec. Okay. Okay, and so then we also need this double trace operator. And so this double trace operator, actually, this will be a particular, is obtained from a condition imposed. So this complex scalar, let's call it phi. Okay, this has nothing to do with imposed on this phi. This I also will show. So this is there's a standard way of treating these double trace operators in ADS-CFT, and so obviously there will be a scalar for this operator. And this will be a higher order term in the asymptotic expansion of this operator. So I will show this to you in a minute too. Okay. Okay. And then when we will write a model which contains all these fields, and then solve the equations of motion, and then we get exactly this structure which I'm about to wipe off. So this was on the field theory side, and now we can recover precisely this on the gravity side with this model. The only difference being that the electrons are no longer free. They are strongly coupled even before you switch on this impurity. Okay, so it's not free electrons coupled to an impurity. It's a strongly correlated electron system coupled to an impurity. So there's an RG flow generated by this. So which you can also see in the equations of motion on the supergravity side. Okay, and as I will show to you hopefully soon, this coupling lambda, which then becomes a coupling as function of the radial variable in your anti-de Sitter space, and this will diverge at a particular scale, as we expect. No, it's two different fields. So there's a capital A and there's a little a. Okay. So this means we write an action for a Chern-Simons field in ADS3 at finite temperature, coupled to a Young-Mills field A mu and a complex scalar phi on an ADS2 defect. Okay. And then when you have this action, you can derive the equations of motion and solve. Solve them. Okay, so this you can only do numerically once you have the finite temperature, but it's rather straightforward to do with mathematical. It's is just a system of coupled ordinary differential equations. And so indeed, then you find that this operator O condenses in the infrared. So, and maybe some of you know this so-called holographic superconductor. So essentially, what your model is an ADS2 holographic superconductor, though it has this extra twist with this double trace operator. Okay, and so yesterday I told you that essentially in the energy limit you have the strongly coupled fixed point and you have some screening which corresponds a little bit like to the formation of mesons. And especially this means that the number of degrees of freedom should actually reduce when you go to the infrared fixed point. And this is actually what you see. So essentially, this charge density is smaller at the horizon than at the boundary of the ADS space, of this ADS2 space. And so this means this Q is reduced, so you have less boxes in your antisymmetric representation. And this means that the electrons hide some of the degrees of freedom of the impurity. Okay, so this means this Q is reduced. So the number of degrees of freedom decreases in the infrared. And so maybe some of you are familiar with the so-called G theorem. So this is a theorem for boundary renormalization group flows. And this is certainly something you you recover here. Okay, so we essentially get a very nice model which has properties which we expect. But I mentioned already a few differences between this field theory condo model which I discussed before and now this gravity condo model. So one of which was that the spin symmetry is gauged, but the other one is that because we're an ADS CFT where everything is strongly coupled in this limit, this means that the electrons are already strongly coupled before they even interact with this impurity. And then this means that this characteristic log behavior at very low temperatures, which I advertised as the reason and sign why people studied this condo model, is actually not here in this model. And but we have something else instead, which is interesting. So there is no log behavior of the resistivity. And rather, there is a power law. And the exponent of this power law is a real number. And this is similar to what you expect from a so-called Luttinger liquid. So this is an electron strongly coupled correlated electron system in 1+1 dimensions. And it's kind of nice that you recover this here. And of course, this would be very nice to investigate further what the properties of this Luttinger liquid are. Okay, so but here we just note that this behavior is expected since our holographic model describes strongly coupled electrons. Okay. Good. So now, before I go into more details about this construction, I would like to summarize a little bit for you what actually the applications or the use of this model is. Not any immediate one, because you just set up this impurity. I mean, I know there's a Trans-Simons field on the gravity side, but not really on the field theory side. I mean, you know, there's also people studying gravity dual models of the quantum Hall effect, but I think that's another, this is not related to what I'm talking about right now. The G-theorem is the boundary equivalent of the C-theorem. Who was asking the question? So you know the C theorem. Okay, so the G theorem is exactly the same, except that the interaction or this quantity which decreases along the RG flow is located at the boundary of a particular space. So here what we're actually considering is an example for a so-called boundary RG flow, because essentially, given this radial coordinates which we introduced, the interaction just takes place at the boundary of our theory. And so, of course, this coupling can also flow, and this is called a boundary RG flow. And so we have a very similar behavior than in the C theorem, because we have a measure for the number of degrees of freedom, and that decreases along the flow. And this is actually very nice, because this is the physical picture which we want. We want to see that these electrons somehow hide the impurity. And if the degrees of freedom of this impurity are hidden in this electron cloud, then obviously the total number of degrees of freedom has to decrease. And so the physical picture agrees with the mathematics. And you can actually write a formal G theorem for this construction, which I'm talking about. Yeah. No. Okay. That's a very good question. I mean, that's one problem of our model, is that we can only solve everything numerically, and we can't really go all the way to absolute zero. Oh, yeah. In the SU2 CAM model, of course it does. Yeah. I mean, there you have a flow which goes from LN2 to zero, essentially. So the entropy. Yes. Yeah. So then you have one spin a half impurity and one spin a half electron, and they just do this and give you a singlet, and then there's no degrees of freedom left, so it goes to zero. But here in this model, things are more complicated, and at least we can't really see that. Okay, I'm getting confused where I was here. Yeah. Yes, this is exactly the idea. I don't claim it's stable. It's unstable. I want it to be unstable because I want this. Very good question. Just give me 5 minutes to you know, I will come to precisely this point. And it's very good that you notice. So when I put this combination of D7 and D5 brains, it will be unstable and there will be a tachyon potential. But this is exactly what will trigger this RG flow which I'm after. I want an instability to leave the fixed point to flow to this new. Yeah, no, that's a very important point. So there is an instability, but it's designed to be there, okay? Yeah, good point. Okay, so I will come to precisely this brain construct in a minute, but just before I do this, let me quickly summarize why this model is useful or interesting, or both. And so one thing is that you can include the back reaction of the defect on the ADS3 space, and this allows you to calculate diese so-called Impurity-Entropie. Okay, so the Impurity-Entropy is defined, so this is called S-Imp. And essentially this S-Imp is defined to be the entanglement entropy when the impurity is present minus the entanglement entropy when the impurity is absent. So essentially what you're going to do, you take an entangling region, which in this case is L, and then so you consider, once you consider the case when there's this impurity there, and then you consider the case when this thing is not there, and then you take the difference. Okay, now I'm going to use the Ryo-Takayanagi formula to calculate this entanglement entropy. So Dan said you should beat me up if I say I use the Ryo-Takayanagi formula to calculate an entanglement entropy. I'm not quite sure why he said that, and maybe it's just a matter of definition how you define entanglement entropy, because I think the von Neumann entropy, you don't necessarily have such a region, and also it vanishes for pure states, isn't it? So I didn't really understand what he was saying there, but okay. So anyway, there's no reason to beat me up. I have an entangling region, and I use the Ryo-Takayanagi formula. So and the essential point is I do this once without this thing, and then I put this thing and I redo the same. And of course, if you put this will somehow deform my, so if this is the radial direction, this will deform the space here, and actually that will change the length of the geodesic. And this is a super nice calculation, which was actually done by some of my grad students who now finished a few months ago. And okay, so we can calculate this using the Ryo-Takayanagi formula. And so the nice thing is that the result we get in this way, in this geometric way, actually agrees with some field theory results which were known previously. So this is a very nice check in this model. So the result agrees with the large N limit of a field theory result. And so the field theory results, they actually do this one paper by Affleck, somebody called La Florence T. And there's an other group which are from Sweden, Henriksson and Johannesson. Okay, so that was extremely reassuring that we were actually able to recover the results. Good. So this is one nice thing you can do. And another nice thing you can do is to look at quantum quenches. So this is similar to what Luis Lena was explaining this morning. And we can just put a time dependence . Okay, so another nice example is you look at the quantum quench, which is you allow for a time dependence for the Kondo coupling. Okay, so this is this. So essentially, you have lambda k of t times this O Dogger. So in your double trace coupling, you allow for this time dependence, so it's a true time, okay? And then obviously your equations of motion will become PDEs, because then you have the radial dependence and the time dependence. But again, I had some extremely good PhD students, grad students, and so they were really super at solving these PDEs. And I should say that took us a while, but eventually we got there. And then you can, for instance, you quench this coupling. You start in the region where you're above this TC, and then you quench the temperature down to this region below TC, and you look at the response of the system. How long does it take for this condensate to form, which then obviously is also a function of T. So then you can, define a time scale, how long it takes to screen this impurity. And this is something which can't be done in condensed matter physics in an easy way. I mean, they use computers for doing that, and certainly this created some interest to compare to condensed matter results. And in particular, we find that for quenches to the screen phase, we see an overdamping. So this condensate forms, and it immediately of this condensate. Okay, so you take your coupling from above the critical temperature to below the critical temperature, and then the system reacts by forming this condensate. And normally you would expect, okay, it goes down and it wiggles around the new equilibrium value, and then these wiggles die down. But here actually there's an overdamping, and it just straight away goes to the new ground state. And this you can study with the quasi-normal modes, which were also mentioned in the talk by Louis Mina this morning. And you can use them precisely, so because again, essentially it's the ringing of a black hole, and so you can use that for gravitational waves, but you can also use that here. And so essentially what we find that in this phase where this overdamping happens, so in the condensed phase, the leading quasi-normal mode is purely imaginary, and it's proportional to the mod of this condensate. Okay? And this is very nice, because this again agrees with results found in condensed matter physics, because in condensed matter physics you expect these frequency, these quasi-normal modes, to correspond to the poles of your Green's functions. And so I think maybe Oliver will tell a little bit about this, calculating correlation functions in ADS CFT. And so the quasi-normal modes coincide. So in ADS CFT, or the quasi-normal modes determine, I should say, the poles of the Green's functions. And so for the ones of this large N field theory condom model, and so this relation is also found in a QFT calculation of the spectral function poles. So the spectral function is related to the Green's functions. In the large N condom model. And this is again a calculation which has been done by Piers Coleman. And so there's this book, Introduction to Many Body Physics, by Piers Coleman. And I think at the last chapter of this book is an entire chapter about the large N condom model. And then, so essentially, our result agrees with that behavior. So this is very reassuring. And so another final nice thing which I would like to mention, which you can do with this model before telling a little bit more how you actually construct it. Okay, I think I will have 5 minutes probably to tell you how you construct this model. At least I should say something about D7 and D5 brains. Okay, so finally, you can calculate two-point functions which requires you to develop the appropriate so-called holographic renormalization, if you have heard about this. And so this confirms this this result for the poles. And also these two-point functions, they have a nice feature, so they display so-called Fano resonances. So Fano was an Italian physicist about the same time as Kondo in the 60s. And so what is a Fano resonance? It's an asymmetry of the spectral function. And it's caused by resonances between the defect and ambient degrees of freedom. And okay, so in the holographic model, they occur, so these Fano resonances, they occur since the conformal symmetry at the defect is broken by this marginally relevant operator. By this double trace operator. So normally this Fano resonances happen if you have a quantum dot, and then you know these electrons, so if here is your quantum dot, and there's some electrons arriving, and so this quantum dot has some discrete energy levels, and then there's some electrons just bind with this quantum dot and they resonate there, and some others just pass through. But then on the other side you see a interference pattern between those. However, if you don't have this quantum dot, but you have our holographic model, then you have a continuum of states here, but since the conformal symmetry is broken, there will also be an interference pattern between those degrees of freedom interacting with the defects and the others. And so this breaking of the conformal symmetry then in 0 plus 1 dimensions has some very important properties for this two-point function and produces these asymmetries. And maybe this is something you could also study in the SYK model, actually. Yeah. So the ambient degrees of freedom. So the defect is our 0 plus 1 dimension object, and the ambient degrees of freedom are the 1 plus 1 dimensional electrons. So ambient refers to something in the 1 plus 1 dimensional space, which is at the boundary of your gravity dual. So ambient means 1 plus 1 in the field theory. Okay. So I think this is some very interesting structure which has kind of theoretical consequences, but it's also relevant for quantum dots, and so we're studying. Okay, so now in the last 5 minutes, let me very quickly say something about the brain construction, also since people ask about it. And indeed, we will find an instability. So the brain construction is as follows. So remember, we want different types of brains because we want fields in the fundamental representation, so they stretch between different brains. And what we do is, so if these are our 10 dimensions, we put n D3 brains in these standard directions, and then we put, so if we just have one flavor of electrons, we take one D7 and one D5 brain, And so the seven brain we put in this direction and then here. So this still by itself would be supersymmetric, okay? And so you see that these degrees of freedom, so 0, 1, 2, 3 are the degrees of freedom of the boundary, or the dimensions of the boundary. And so you will see that this will give you some fermions which are in the fundamental representations, because there will be strings between the D3 and D7 brains, but these fermions will just live in 1 plus 1 dimensions, okay? Because these two are empty. And so these are the internal spaces. So that will give us electrons, so the psi fields. And then we put D5 brains, and so now if we don't put this D7 and just the D5, it will still be supersymmetric. And so then you can have strings between these D3 and the D5. And so here these fields only live in the time direction, you see. So that will be our chi's, okay? So they live in 0 plus 1 dimension. But now, as you rightly pointed out, if I put both of them, then I get something which has 2 and d directions. And so this is unstable. So putting both d7 and d5s produces an instability and so this means there will be a tachyon potential, and so the problem is it's not very easy to calculate the exact form of this potential. And that's the reason why at this point we then resort to a model where we just write the simplest possible term, just a mass term for this potential, which just reflects this marginally relevant behavior of this double trace operator. And okay, so it's expected that there's an instability, but this will flow again to a IR fixed point. Although we can't do an explicit calculation, at least for now. And okay, so just to conclude, because there's this complication, then we actually turn. So the model which we actually consider looks as follows. So as I said, we turn to a simpler bottom-up model. And so essentially, this model has an Einstein-Hilbert term. In 2 plus 1 dimensions, so this should be a 3, sorry. Then, okay, so then we put a transimons. For the electrons. But actually, when you solve the equations of motion, they actually, you can solve the equations of motion for the 2D, for the 1 plus 1, so for the fields on the ADS2. Separately, and then determine what this implies for this. So this is not a dynamical field, obviously, because it's transimons. And then, so the essential part happens at the defect, where you have an integral over time, and then an integral over the radial direction in this ADS2 space. And so then here you have this Young-Mills field, which I called A mu, which determines the size of the representation in the chart. So because this was little a mu, so there's a little f mu nu here. So this is in 1 plus 1 dimensions. And then we have our complex scalar, which provides both the double trace coupling and with the standard ADS-CFT double trace technique, and also it provides the condensate. And then we have a potential for this scalar. And here we just take a mass term. Okay, so the covariant derivative contains terms both involving this capital gauge field but also the small gauge field. And okay, so then we choose the potential to be m squared phi lega phi such with the mass torsion such that this double trace operator is marginally relevant. Okay, and then so you can use this usual Witten prescription for double trace operators, and okay, and then you just solve the equations of motion and then get all the beautiful things which I explained to you before. Okay, so I guess this brings me to the end of my lecture. So I liked it very much. Thanks for asking so many questions, and I enjoyed this very much. I hope you did too, and if you have further questions, I would be very happy. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so he wrote this paper in 1964, so... Ah, actually, yeah, okay, I will do that.
By the way, in your model, what is the difference?
Yeah, okay, so... Okay, the story is slightly complicated, so... so far, okay, let me... So... So far, what we get is, okay, so the way we obtained this, this was before we started, so obviously you would get this from the conductivity for which you have to calculate the two-point functions. And we set up all this formalism to calculate the two-point functions. There's just a problem because we really just have one single impurity, and so our Chern-Simons field is non-dynamical, so the two-point function just has the delta function, essentially. But you can determine this from a so-called leading irrelevant operator analysis. And so this means you do conformal perturbation theory about the IR fixed point. And so we are actually able to determine what our leading irrelevant operators are. And then here we get essentially T to some number. And this number is a real. Okay, it's a real, so it's something like, I think I remember it's something like 1.07 or so. And so which we determine numerically. And this looks strange, but this is what you expect for a Luttinger liquid. So the difference of our, so this log only happens if the electrons are free. And I think just also from the analysis of conformal field theories, if you let n to be infinity, you won't see this log anymore. What this real number means is that our electrons are, so obviously our electrons are not free, they are strongly coupled, they are strongly correlated by somehow the nx^4 degrees of freedom which are still somehow around in the system. And so it's more like a Luttinger liquid and not like free electrons. And Luttinger liquids precisely have such a behavior with a real number. And so I think that points out some work to be done, which is to understand better Luttinger liquids in the context of ADS-CFT. So I think there are 3 or 4 papers where people started to study this. But certainly here, I mean, I've given many talks about this to condensed matter physicists, and then at this point they will always ask me, oh, great, we know Luttinger liquids, so what are the Luttinger parameters of your model? And then I have to say, sorry, it's not so easy. You know, there's nx^4 super young Mills involved. And then they say, oh my god. but I'm sure this can be addressed. And then, so if we knew more about these Luttinger parameters, this would also be something which really convince condensed matter physicists. Yeah, so the other thing is, maybe using a higher spin theory, we could actually have a model where we have free fermions at the boundary rather than this complicated system, but then you need to somehow put a boundary, then you can't just put a simple defect there because alpha prime goes to infinity. So this is another nice project which would be to cook up a real large n quantum model by using higher spin theory, maybe. And okay, so just to say that there's still many open questions and things to be done. And yes, okay. Yeah. Okay, okay, so I would have to, yeah. I mean, this is something, you know, because, I mean, this coefficient, I mean, this log behavior is really determined by the conformal field theory at the IR fixed point. And so there, some people classified all quantum models, boundary conformal field theories for any value of n and any number of channels, and they also have results. So I think in the large n limit, it's clear that you will never see this log. But I have to check this Wilson result as well. That would be interesting. Yeah.
Why is the cosinor most proportional to the norm of the whole
world? Well, okay, so this is not, okay, so we only essentially found this numerically, okay. So what we do is, so obviously when you study this quantum quench, you have to solve the PDEs, and this you can only do numerically, but then you can analyze the quasi-normal modes, and then you can see that this they have this behavior. Similarly for the two-point functions, again, I mean, you can write lots of things analytically, but at the end, when you really want to calculate the spectral function as a function of the frequency, then you have to do a numerical calculation. But then again, you can do a fit to this leading quasi-normal mode, and it looks like this. Now, unfortunately, there is not an easy argument to see why it has to be like this. So I recommend this book by Piers Coleman called Introduction to Many Body Physics, chapter 18, which is the last chapter of the book, and that's where we got this from. But if you actually look into this book, you will not see this formula written anywhere. We extracted it somehow from the text, which wasn't super easy. But okay, so I talked to him, to Piers Coleman, and he actually confirmed that this is what is the follows from his calculation on the field theory side as well. So, okay, I don't think there's an argument, intuitive argument, why it should be like this, but it's very interesting to know that you have this overdamping here, and it's just purely imaginary. It's an interesting non-trivial fact, but it's not something you can derive from some scaling argument or something like this. But maybe you can, and I would be very interested in that.
Yeah, thanks.